everyone, and welcome to the worship of God with the Congregational Church of Batavia. In the words of our parent denomination, the United Church of Christ, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you're always welcome here. And we really mean that. We're so glad that you've chosen to spend part of a holiday weekend with us here in worship. I have a number of announcements because it really is that time of year. I said it last week, I'll say it again. Everybody says summer slows down and they're lying. There's so much going on, and so I wanted to keep you up to date on a few things. First of all, today is a Communion Sunday, and that means that there are three things I want to remind you of here at the top of the service. The first is that children will be staying with us throughout the worship service this morning so that they can participate in Communion. If you want, there are coloring pages and bags and crayons available by the door where you came in if you're looking for something to do. And that goes for adults as well, if you're feeling so inclined. Second, if you haven't already gotten them, communion elements are available on the table leading into Paxton Hall. You can choose communion wafers that are made by our very own Sunday schoolers and grapes instead of grape juice because it doesn't spill. Or you can get the prepackaged wafer and juice, whichever suits you better. And third, everyone is welcome to participate in communion. It doesn't matter if you're a member or if you're visiting with us. It doesn't matter if you're an adult or a child, if you're solid in your faith or if you have doubts. You are welcome here because this is God's table of grace. I wanted to take a moment and turn the microphone over to Bob Huxtable on behalf of Outreach.
So good morning. This is the time of year where we participate with the rest of the United Church of Christ in the Strength of the Church offering. And some of you I know are familiar with that, maybe not everybody, but the theme this year is Renew, and we're helping churches across America in their renewal. And I found a neat story online at the UCC. Plymouth Congregational Church in Lawrence, Kansas last year partnered with a local organization to help students at the Haskell Indian Nations University. And I'll be honest, this is the first time I've heard of this. It's a university specifically for Native Americans, and it's kind of a neat place. As we know, there's certain populations in America that were really affected very harshly by COVID, and indigenous peoples are one of them. So for instance, they partnered to help students there throughout the year who needed a special assistance. One Navajo student received assistance through the church because they had to fly home to attend and plan funerals for family members. Another one was coming back from home out west, a Lakota woman, and her car broke down. And they helped her so that she could get back to campus and get back to school. And throughout the year, the Plymouth Congregational Church in Lawrence was supporting the various students in various different ways. They did this through building relationships on campus with the students. And I just think this is one of the stories. There's many more things that are happening with Strength of the Church, but as it says here, the renewal of our congregation and our congregational life takes many forms. In Lawrence, Kansas, it meant forming significant relationships to support students affected by COVID. So you can help with this offering by going to congregationalchurch.org. You can text to give by taking your phone, going to 73256 and typing in CCoB space STC, Strength of the Church. And of course, a check written to our church with STC in the memo line would also be awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Again, if you haven't yet already gotten your communion elements, now is a great time to get up and grab them. They're right out there waiting for you. I also wanted to give everybody the opportunity to fill out a sanctuary survey. We have put out a digital survey to see if people are comfortable returning to the sanctuary anytime soon. We are aware that not all of you are computer savvy. I'm certainly not. I do what I do, and that's about the end of it. I don't do anything extra. So we also have hard copies right here on the table. So if you want to, Please take one of the hard copies home with you today and simply return it to the office, and that will be the way that we will hear your voice. I also wanted to extend a special thank you this morning to Bob, who is going to be our liturgist, as well as doing announcements for us, and to Haley for providing us with special music. These are both gifts that are part of the network and the fabric of what it is to be part of the body of Christ, and our worship is richer and more complete for their being here and doing that. And if you want to be part of worship, all you have to do is drop me an email anytime. That said, you're invited to breathe deeply into this space, to center yourselves in the moment, and to know that God is on the journey with us and is meeting us here.
Thank you.
One of the cool things that we get to do today when we gather together is have a new member joining. And so last week after worship service, I met with Martha, who's going to be joining us in a little later in the service. And we were talking a little bit about the United Church of Christ and the congregation here. And the United Church of Christ statement of faith came up in conversation. And so I thought to myself, that would be a wonderful time to use the UCC statement of faith on our new member joining. It is a sign of God's presence. It is a sign of God's love for us, and it is the opportunity for us to say out loud those things that we believe. It's not a creed where you have to sign on the bottom line and you have to believe it or you can't be part of the group. Instead, it's just an expression of those things that we believe. So I invite you to join me in the United Church of Christ statement of faith, which is in your bulletin. We believe in you, O God, eternal Spirit, God of our Savior, Jesus Christ, and our God, and to your deeds we testify. You call worlds into being, create persons in your own image, and set before each one the ways of life and death. You seek in humble love to save all people from aimlessness and sin. You judge people and nations by your righteous will, declared through prophets and apostles. In Jesus Christ, the man of Nazareth, our crucified and risen Savior, you have come to us and shared our common lot, conquering sin and death and reconciling the world to yourself. You bestow upon us your Holy Spirit, creating and renewing the Church of Jesus Christ, binding in covenant faithful people of all ages, tongues, and races. You call us into your church to accept the cost and joy of discipleship, to be your servants in the service of others, to proclaim the gospel to all the world and resist the powers of evil, to share in Christ's baptism and eat at his table, to join him in his passion and victory. You promise to all who trust you forgiveness of sins and fullness of grace, courage in the struggle for justice and peace, your presence in trial and rejoicing, and eternal life in your realm which has no end. Blessing and honor, glory and power be unto you. Amen. Amen. At this time, I'd like to invite our Vice Moderator Dean to come forward, and we are going to have the reception of new members, which is a joyful event in any congregation. So, we invite to come forward all of those who wish to unite with us in this household of faith. You can just stand here right between us and look charming. Friends in Christ, we are all received into the church, the sacrament of baptism, and the covenant that we make here today. Martha has found nurture and support in the midst of the family of Christ. Through prayer and study, she has been led by the Holy Spirit to affirm her baptism and to claim in our presence her covenantal relationship with Christ and the members of this congregation. She is here for service to Jesus Christ, using the gift which the Holy Spirit bestows.
Hear the words of Jesus. I am the vine, you are the branches. Anyone who abides in me, and I in that person, is the one who bears much fruit. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you will, and it shall be done for you. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full.
We're going to take a moment now to ask you some questions that you get to answer. I have to tell you what to say, so don't worry about it. Martha, do you desire to affirm your baptism into the faith and family of Jesus Christ? If so, please say, I do.
I do.
Do you renounce the powers of evil and desire the freedom of new life in Christ? If so, please say, I do.
I do.
Do you profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior? Again, if so, please say, I do.
I do.
Do you promise, by the grace of God, to be Christ's disciple, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and word of Jesus Christ as best as you are able. If so, please say, I promise with the help of God.
I promise with the help of God.
And do you promise, according to the grace given to you, to grow in the Christian faith, to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ, celebrating Christ's presence and furthering Christ's mission in all the world? Again, if so, say, I promise with the help of God.
I promise with the help of God.
Just one more. Do you promise to participate in the life and mission of this family of God's people, sharing regularly in the worship of God and enlisting in the work of this local church as it serves the community and the world? If so, please say, I promise with the help of God.
I promise with the help of God.
Then let us all reunite with the church in all time and places in confessing our faith in the triune of God. These questions are for everyone here today. Do you believe in God? If so, say, I believe in God.
I believe in God.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ? If so, say, I believe in Jesus Christ.
I believe in Jesus Christ.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? If so, say, I believe in the Holy Spirit.
I believe in the Holy Spirit. By your baptism and the promises, you were made one with us in the body of Christ, the Church. Today we rejoice in your pilgrimage of faith, which has brought you to this time and place. We give thanks for every community of faith that has been your spiritual home, and we celebrate your presence in this household of faith. Let us then, the members of the Congregational Church of Batavia, express our welcome and affirm our mutual ministry of Christ with the words that are printed in your bulletin. We welcome you with joy in the common life of this church. We promise you our friendship and prayers as we share the hopes and labors of the Church of Jesus Christ. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we continue to grow together in God's knowledge and love and be witnesses of our risen Savior.
In the name of Jesus Christ, and on behalf of the Congregational Church of Batavia, we extend the hand of Christian love, welcoming you into the company of this local church.
And as a sign and symbol of that, we give you a plant, which is ever growing, as is your faith and your commitment to being part of this congregation. And we are so blessed because of that. Thank you. If your heart is willing, let's just have one more moment. O God, we praise you for calling us to faith and for gathering us into the church, the body of Christ. We thank you for your people gathered in this local congregation, and we rejoice that you have increased our community of faith. Together may we live in the Spirit, building one another up in love, sharing in the life and worship of the church, and serving the world for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Follow up. There we go. Thank you. It's that time in the service where we take a moment to consider all of the ways that we can give to the ministry of this congregation here. Part of that, of course, is money, and we ask that you take that seriously and to heart, but it's also the gifts that you have to bring. Hospitality, music, the gift of joy and celebration and being present together, anything that you bring with us makes us better because you are here, and we are blessed because of that. So while you consider that, you are invited to listen to our musical reflection on this fantastic holiday weekend.
Beautiful, spacious skies forevermore.
things this morning about the people of Israel in the wilderness, and they did not need maps or a GPS. So, two readings from the Hebrew Bible, starting with Exodus 13, 20 to 22. They set out from Succoth and camped at Etham on the edge of the wilderness. The Lord went in front of them in a pillar of cloud by day to lead them along the way, and a pillar of fire by night to give them light so that they might travel by day and by night. Now neither the pillar of cloud by day nor the pillar of fire by night left its place in front of the people of Israel. Our second reading, also from Exodus, chapter 40, verses 34 to 38. Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud settled upon it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Whenever the cloud was taken up from the tabernacle, the Israelites would set out on each stage of their journey. But if the cloud was not taken up, then they did not set out until the day that it was taken up. For the cloud of the Lord was on the tabernacle by day, and fire was in the cloud by night, before the eyes of all of the house of Israel. May God add a blessing to the reading, hearing, and understanding of God's holy word. Amen.
Rested on the tabernacle of the Lord. Turns out that 5,000 years of living with and learning from these foundational stories can lead to quite a depth of wisdom and insight. So as I've said, humorous. In my own defense, however, I wasn't entirely wrong in my interpretation of this story of the twin pillars as being part of the signs of God's presence on the human journey. Many, a rabbi and Jewish theologian, pointed that out as one of the many meanings of this story. So I was in good company. It's just that it's so much more nuanced than my simple interpretation allowed. And I want to explore a little bit of that nuance this morning, because it helps to nurture and strengthen our relationship to the God who chooses to travel with us. So for example, Rabbi Bradley Artson writes in his article, "A Cloud by Day, a Fire by Night," that the expression of fire and cloud represent two distinct modes of human relation to God. He describes it like this: expressing a theology of encounter, the fire, with more definite form and substance, represents acute interaction with God. In biblical terms, these are moments of revelation. In our lives, they are birth, marriage, death, and other times when we feel the imminent presence of God. On the other hand, the cloud expresses a theology of presence, the continuing relationships we develop through parenthood, marriage, and mourning. The two pillars illustrating that God was with the Hebrew in the book of Exodus humbles us, and it reminds us just when we think that we've got God tied up in a nice, neat little package with a bow, that in point of fact, we don't. We can't, because God is so much greater than our ability to comprehend. And through some miracle, it is this indescribable, incomprehensible, infinite God who chooses to travel with us. A final flash of insight struck me when I read the musings of Rabbi Rachel Barenblatt, who blogs as the Velveteen Rabbi, which I think is just hysterical. She points out that God, through the pillars of cloud and fire, does not actually lead the Hebrew people on a direct path from slavery in Egypt to freedom in the land of Canaan, but instead leads them on a circuitous and repetitive route through the wilderness, a journey that takes them 40 years. The conventional explanation for this extended delay is not that God, is that God was punishing the people for their disobedience. That when God directed them to enter the land of Canaan, they responded with fear rather than faith and flat out refused. So God led them on this wild goose chase that lasted four decades until all of the unfaithful, disobedient ones had passed away. But the Velveteen Rabbi offers an alternative interpretation, one that I like better, not just because it's kinder and gentler, but because it comports more with my experience of God than this other explanation does. See, she suggests that rather than a punishment, this time of wandering was for the people's healing, their recovery from the wounds inflicted by generations of slavery in a foreign land. She writes, slavery damages not only the body, but also the soul, and that kind of constriction lingers in the heart. God knew it would take the Israelites 40 years to learn another way of being. It must have been so frightening at first, being free. After a lifetime of unquestioned allegiance to Pharaoh, choosing allegiance to the source of all being must have seemed like an unimaginable leap of faith. Fortunately, though their new God was beyond comprehension and beyond human sight, the Israelites knew their mysterious God was with them, thanks to the divine cloud. 40, in the Bible, of course, is the span of time symbolic of completion and fulfillment. In Noah's time, it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. David, the greatest king of Israel, ruled for 40 years. Jesus was tempted for 40 days in the desert. The number 40 signifies not just God's presence, but also God's work in, among, and through us. Interestingly enough, modern medical and psychological studies have found that 6 weeks, or right around 40 days, is the amount of time it takes to break an old habit or to create a new one. And the study of family systems tells us that it takes two full generations, approximately 40 years, to break free from unhealthy and inherited family patterns, such as alcoholism or abuse. So whether you're reading the Bible or psychology today, 40 seems to be the magic number of recovery, for healing, for transformation to occur. I'm not suggesting that literally 40 days or 40 years is what it will take for change to happen, for freedom to take root in our lives. The number 40 here, like the story of the pillars of cloud and fire itself, is merely a symbol, a metaphor. And in this case, it's a metaphor for the time and space needed to leave one way of being and live into a new life. None of us, of course, are literal slaves. That's a very strong word with a lot of history and baggage, and I will not use it lightly. But I do think it's fair to say that all of us have at some point in our lives experienced what it is to be held captive, enthralled to something that has not been in our best interest. The Statement of Faith of the United Church of Christ, which we just read together, calls this state of being aimlessness and sin. Isn't that profoundly imaginative language? You can call it that, you can call it whatever you want, but we've all been there in the lostness, in the darkness, in need of something a lot like salvation. And this story, the story of God leading the people through the wilderness for 40 years, reminds us that it takes time for healing to occur, for recovery to happen, for transformation to take place. But it does, and it will, it must, because God has chosen to be present with us in our lives in ways big and small. If we ever doubt that, all we need ever do is look for the signs. They may not be as obvious as a pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire. They may not be fireworks in the sky, but they are there nonetheless to encourage and strengthen and support us on the journey to freedom. Liberation. For the reality that God has chosen to travel and to work in among and through us, and for the signs of that holy presence that are everywhere, we give thanks today. Amen. This table is one of those places where we experience a sign of God's presence, tangible, real. We can touch it, we can taste it, and we know that God is near. Again, I want to tell you that this table does not belong to any pastor or any church or any denomination. It belongs to Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ has invited you. So if you hear that call, you're welcome here. Beloved in Christ, the gospel tells us that on the first day of the week, Jesus Christ was raised from death, appeared to Mary Magdalene, and on that same day sat at the table with two disciples and was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the joyful feast of the people of God, all God's people, youth and children, come from the east and the west, from the north and the south, and gather about Christ's table. This table is for all people who wish to know the presence of Christ and to share in the community of God's people. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to God Most High.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
We give you thanks, God of majesty and mercy, for calling forth the creation and raising us from the dust by the breath of your being. We bless you for the beauty and bounty of the earth, and for the vision of the day when sharing by all will mean scarcity for none. We remember the covenant you made with your people Israel, and we give you thanks for all of our ancestors in faith. We rejoice that you call us to reconciliation with you and all people everywhere, and that you remain faithful to your covenant even when we were faithless. We rejoice that you call the entire human family to this table of sacrifice and victory. We come in remembrance and celebration of the gift of Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be the good news. Born of Mary, our sister in faith, Christ lived among us to reveal the mystery of your word, to suffer and die on the cross for us, to be raised from death on the third day, and then to live in glory. We bless you, gracious God, for the presence of your Holy Spirit in the church that you have gathered, with your children of faith in all places and times, we praise you with joy. Holy, 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 God of love and majesty, the whole universe speaks of your glory, O God Most High. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our God, Hosanna in the highest. We remember that on the night of betrayal and desertion, and on the eve of death, Jesus gathered his disciples for the feast of the Passover. He took the bread after giving thanks to you, and he broke it, and he gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Eternal God, we unite in this covenant of faith, recalling Christ's suffering and death, rejoicing in his resurrection, and awaiting Christ's return in victory. We spread the table with the gifts of the earth and of our labor. We present to you our very lives, committed to your service on behalf of all people. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit on this bread and cup, on the gifts and on us. Strengthen your universal church that it may be the champion of peace and justice in all the world. Restore the earth with your grace that is able to make all things new. Be present with us as we share this meal and throughout all our lives, that we may know you as the Holy One, who with Christ and the Holy Spirit lives forever. This is the body of Christ, and it is given to us as gift. This is the blood of Christ, which is also given to us as gift and blessing. The gifts of God for the people of God come, for all things are ready. Take and eat. This is the body of Christ. Taste and see that God is good. And this is the cup of God's great blessing. Take and drink. God, you are invited to join me in our prayer of thanksgiving together. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the simplicity and splendor of this holy meal. Unite us with all who are fed by Christ's body and blood, that we may faithfully proclaim the good news of your love, and that your universal church may be a rainbow of hope in an uncertain world. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Come to the time in our service where we share our joys and concerns. We continue to pray for our country, especially on this 4th of July weekend. As we celebrate the birth and independence of this nation, we also recognize that things are not as they should be, so we pray. We continue to hold in our thoughts and prayers Jackie Winfield as she recovers. We ask that God will be with Daryl Schrail, and we hold in our hands and our hearts Nicholas Max. If your heart is willing, please join me in prayer. God of liberation, God of independence, God of freedom, we thank you today that we have the right and the ability to be in this place together to worship you. We thank you for the freedom that we experience in this country. And as we celebrate the birth of this nation,
We give thanks that we were born here and can be part of the freedom and the rights that have been given to us. We also recognize that things are not as they should be. There is much division in this country. There is not equality for everyone. And we ask that you will show us how we, as your people, can walk alongside those who need it most, how we can make things better, how we can bring equality and dignity and justice to all. And we also ask that you will show us the ways that we can help bridge the divisions that separate us in these powerful ways, because you are greater than those things. As we gather together, we do pray that you'll be with everybody who is celebrating this weekend. Give them safety. We give thanks for the opportunity they have to be with family and friends. And we ask that you'll be with the members of our community who can't be here with us today because they are celebrating with loved ones. We continue to pray, as we do, for those in our midst who need you in a special way right now. We ask that you'll be with Jackie as she continues to get strength and to heal from her fall. We hold before you Daryl, and we ask that you be with her and her health as well, and thank you for a family that loves her so much. And we ask that you be with Nicholas as he undergoes treatment. Give him strength and a sense of your presence. I know that there are so many other things in our hearts today that we haven't said out loud, both joys and concerns. And so, in this moment of silence, we turn them all over to you, knowing that there is no better place for them to be than in your hands. In the week to come, strengthen us, nurture us, give us signs of your presence that you are working in, among, and through us. And remind us always that we are your beloved children. We ask all this in the name of Jesus Christ, and it's his family prayer that we pray together today. Our Father, our Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors.
Lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Our closing hymn is Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. You're invited to stand as you're able for this as well.
Thank you.
confidence, for the God of the universe goes before you, leading you along your path. That same God walks behind you, guarding you on this journey. God walks beside you, your constant companion in life. God is the solid ground beneath your feet and the glory of the skies, but most importantly, in the person and work of Jesus Christ, God goes within you. So go forth today and shine. Amen. You may be seated for our postlude, and ignore me while I turn off my camera.
Thank you.